How do we chart the history of the alt-right? To here, 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 here. First, what is the alt-right? The term is difficult to define. To analyze the genealogy of a movement, it might be best to clarify a number of conceptual ingredients. Let's take, for example, leaders, economics and technology, and ideas. At its strictest, Angela Nagel defines the alt-right in her book Kill All Normies as a new wave of overtly white segregationist and white nationalist movements and subcultures. It could also be defined as a new wave of conservatives who don't fit into our traditional definition of conservatism. It is, Nagel continues, typified by spokespeople like Richard Spencer, who has called for a white US ethnostate and a pan-national white empire, modelled on some approximation of the Roman Empire. Economically, the alt-right varies. Not all are libertarians or even economically conservative, and many are even socialists or anti-corporatists. What's important is that the movement doesn't fit into the traditional left-right spectrum, and is illustrative of a new spectrum between loosely globalists or internationalists and nationalists. So, leaders. There are four figures we can emphasize as being typical of the alt-right movement that have sometimes similar but sometimes varying views. Richard Spencer, Milo Yiannopoulos, Kevin B. MacDonald, and Jared Taylor. But what about this guy? This is Harambe. Nagel charts the rise of the alt-right to the meme culture that developed online in response to videos like Kony 2012 and the shooting of Harambe the gorilla after a child climbed into its enclosure in Cincinnati in 2016. Kony 2012 was a slickly made video about the Ugandan war criminal and leader of the Lord's Resistance Army, Joseph Kony. The video, while record-breaking in terms of how viral it went, and famous for its brief water-cooler popularity, was heavily criticised for its oversimplification and focus on its white presenter.
We are also going to do everything that we can to stop them. Do you hear my words? You know what I mean? We're going to stop them.
Both viral stories, Nagel claims, represented the hegemony of Western liberalism, which opponents saw as faux liberals virtue signalling about issues they didn't really care about, and promoting clicktivism, a type of activism that encourages liking or sharing a video or link about an issue that might make you look charitable and empathetic in the moment, but requires no real effort and has very little effect on the issue. To some, this was illustrative of a kind of liberal hypocrisy that fed off virtue signalling visibility. It's easy to share a story about Joseph Kony from your living room, and the filmmaker comes across as narcissistic, naive and vain, turning a film about a complicated and violent issue in Africa into something about him and his son, not to mention the parallels with the idea of the white man's burden. This, to its detractors, was what liberalism was becoming. Combine this with the 2008 financial crisis, the stagnation of wages, and the increase in poverty in the West, and you already have an increasingly contentious political environment. And so, if even a small part of some people's motivations to share stories like this on Facebook was to look good, then it's no wonder that opposition to it germinated in a place that was based around anonymity. Which leads to technology. 4chan is a message board where users can post an image for other users to vote and comment on. Its unique feature is that anyone can post without a username or account. Because it's anonymous, 4chan became a hotbed for subjects that are taboo or politically incorrect, especially racism, sexism, and homophobia. It's almost the antithesis to politically correct posts on Facebook. Computer scientist Gabrielle Emile Hein and others conducted a study on 4chan. They used the hate-based dictionary of over 1,000 global hate terms and found that 12% of the politically incorrect forum posts contained one or more of these hate words. That's compared to about 2.2% on other social media platforms. So the cynical definition of political correctness, and whether this is right or wrong is another video entirely, is that political correctness penalises people socially for using certain inflammatory language. Political correctness draws the boundaries of what is socially acceptable, which is precisely why Pepe the Frog has become a mascot for the alt-right. Pepe was a comic book character created by Matt Fiori in 2005, who had no intention of it representing the ideology of those who came to adopt it. Originally, in Fiori's comic, Pepe was featured engaged in activities like urinating or getting stoned, with the catchphrase, "Feels good, man." In other words, Pepe didn't care about political correctness. He was then appropriated by the alt-right, used as a basis for thousands of different derogatory memes, and has since been included in the Anti-Defamation League's database of hate symbols. Then, 2 years after Kony 2012, Gamergate happened, another catalyst for the movement. Gamergate started when a video game about depression received attention in the media, and positive reviews became widely ridiculed online by gamers used to games about war and violence, who mocked the social justice warrior attitude of the developers and the reviewers. Many involved were at the receiving end of hateful, sexist, and threatening abuse by many. But Gamergate became emblematic of a culture war that was developing online through hashtags that, at first, had no leaders and no demands. But back to leaders. This coincided with the rise of websites like the right-wing Breitbart, founded in 2007, which itself gave rise to Milo Yiannopoulos, Ben Shapiro, and Steve Bannon, who all shared a similar disdain for liberal political correctness. Milo, young, fashionable, articulate, gay, and Jewish, was everything you expected someone on the right, let alone the alt-right, not to be, and so undoubtedly and unquantifiably brought a lot of attention to the movement. There's some debate as to whether Yiannopoulos should be labelled alt-right, and he himself rejects the label, saying, "We're fellow travellers on some issues, but I'm very pro-Iraq and very pro-Israel. There are all sorts of points of difference, I think." But he certainly provides a bridge between some contentious but more mainstream views and the alt-right, usually through one-off comments that he claims are meant to be taken as jokes. He has sometimes been classified as alt-light. And let's not forget this guy.
"I don't like them putting chemicals in the water that turn the friggin' frogs gay. Do you understand that? Serious crap."
Whose website receives 7.5 million unique visitors per month, and whose YouTube channel has over 2 million subscribers. Then we have Richard Spencer, who, as Scott McConnell has written, provides a bridge between the alt-right and the older generation of white nationalists. Spencer believes in peaceful ethnic cleansing to turn the United States into a white ethnostate and a pan-European white empire, modelled loosely on the Roman Empire. It is Spencer that coined the term alt-right. Most notably, he writes for Tacky Magazine, a paleoconservative online publication that advocates for small government and a strong religious conservative identity, and he's the president of the white supremacist organisation, the National Policy Institute. At a meeting of the organisation that took place after Trump was elected, Spencer gave the crowd a Nazi salute and shouted,
"Hail Trump! Hail our people! Hail victory!"
The older generation Spencer provides a bridge between includes, most notably, Jared Taylor. Taylor founded the magazine American Renaissance in 1990. The publication's modus operandi begins, "Race is an important aspect of individual and group identity. Of all the fault lines that divide society, language, religion, class, ideology, it is the most prominent and divisive. Race and racial conflict are at the heart of some of the most serious challenges the Western world faces in the 21st century." Taylor believes that differences between races or ethnicities are natural, and so organizing society so that nations are racially homogenous is also natural. He calls this race realism and believes that in intelligence, Asian people are genetically superior to white people, who are in turn genetically superior to black people. He's written 6 books and makes appearances on shows like The Political Cesspool, a white supremacist internet podcast. He's also been featured on CNN. And so to ideas. Kevin B. MacDonald represents the academic, some say pseudo-academic, underpinnings of the alt-right. Spencer himself has remarked that there is no man on the planet who has done more for the understanding of the pole around which the world revolves than Kevin MacDonald. MacDonald, a former professor of psychology, has argued that Jewish group success can be attributed to evolutionary tactics like group altruism, in-group reproduction, and group homogeneity, that leads to qualities including higher than average verbal intelligence and economic success. Because of this, MacDonald advocates cultural homogeneity between distinct races. His work has been widely criticised. Steven Pinker wrote that it contains a consistently invidious portrayal of Jews, couched in value-laden, disparaging language. Nathan Kofness has written that MacDonald's most influential book, The Culture of Critique, is chock-full of misrepresented sources, cherry-picked facts, and egregious distortions of history. Either way, it's ideas like this, theories about race, ethnicity, national identity or culture, being exclusive or biological, that the alt-right tend to champion. Where theories about race like that of MacDonald's exist on the edge of any mainstream or widely accepted philosophy, the alt-right, like racially motivated groups like the Nazis before them, have a tendency to distort or exaggerate the views of more mainstream philosophers to give themselves legitimacy. Spencer, for example, is a fan of Nietzsche, who was famously misrepresented by the Nazis. In his book Dangerous Minds, Ronald Beiner notes that far-right websites tend to cite Nietzsche and Heidegger in particular, thinkers that talk about power and the importance of Volk, the community, respectively. Some of the more socially acceptable themes of the alt-right might be traced back to Pat Buchanan, who ran in the Republican presidential primaries in 1992, 96, and 2000. He of course lost them all, but was a popular figure for his opposition to multiculturalism, abortion, and gay rights, and his support for the average working class man. He became known as Pitchfork Pat. A speech he gave after his defeat in 1992 has been referred to as the culture war speech, something that Yiannopoulos would frequently reference.
There is a religious war going on in this country. It is a cultural war as critical to the kind of nation we shall be as the Cold War itself, for this war is for the soul of America.
Buchanan's book, Death of the West, has been hugely influential in paleoconservative circles, that is, conservatism that emphasizes tradition, religion, and limited government. The alt-right, in varying and sometimes loose ways, draws on much of this. The alt-right themselves, though, were relatively obscure until 2015, when the New York Times and BuzzFeed both ran pieces on them, which begs another question. How much are the media responsible for the rise and fall of extreme movements? But we can't ignore economic and material issues like the rise of immigration into the EU, wars in the Middle East, and terrorist attacks like the Bataclan and Charlie Hebdo, not to mention 9/11, all of which provide ammunition for the movement. A lot of the alt-right's thought also parallels the argument that globalization has disenfranchised the working class, and so oddly there are some affinities there with the left. So there it is, a few technological and economic ingredients, a few leaders, a few ideas, and a large dollop of racism make up what has become the alt-right. If you want to support Then and Now, then please subscribe below, and most importantly, click the bell here to receive notifications when I upload a new video. You can also follow me on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram in the links in the description below. And if you're feeling really generous, then this channel only exists through the support of pledges on Patreon, where you can support new content with as little as a dollar for each new video. Thanks for watching. See you next week.